Really happy to be here and introduce a friend, a partner, a mentor, Troy, who's, I think Mark Cuban's got nothing on you, but that's just me.
He's a couple zeros.
Troy's a prolific investor and what I like to call an entrepreneur investor. Really curious for people and ideas. He's in Uber, Dropbox, Spotify, just to name a few. He's also an artist manager to some of the biggest and well-known artists in the world, Lady Gaga, John Legend, John Mayer, Miguel, to name a few. And more than anything, I think for me, he's a great friend, a great father, a great son, and that's what I admire most about him. So really happy to present and introduce you guys to Troy Carter.
Welcome. Thanks so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
It's great to have you back on this side of campus instead of cinema. Thanks for being here. And thanks, James. It's really nice to sort of have the full circle moment, as Oprah would say, to sort of have a USC person and say, I can't wait to sort of share his story with you, as I know, you know, you find great talent, whether it's musical or business or a young star like that. So we'll talk about that. Here, so your class is 18 to 22 year olds, freshmen to seniors, all majors. And the class is really, it's an entrepreneur's class, but it's about the mindset of greatness. Sort of like Inside the Actor's Studio for entrepreneurs, where you really sort of share your lessons, stories, advice, and things like that. And so if you don't mind, we'll sort of head through your life. But first, tell us what an artist manager is, does, and sort of what a typical day is like for you.
Wow, today was one of those days, by the way. But you know, artist managers basically, we do career development for music talent, basically. So you know, our job is to, you know, we basically meet young acts who come to us with their vision, and my job is to be able to see that into fruition. I do a lot of blocking and tackling. You know, we do everything from negotiate the record deals to the publishing deals to the touring deals, brand endorsement deals, basically build out their creative teams around them. We build out the business units around them as well, and make sure that they're accomplishing their goals both, you know, creatively and financially.
And much different than probably even 10 years ago in terms of the tools available, the responsibilities of the breadth of responsibilities of a manager. How has that sort of changed recently for you?
You know, I think the psychology remains the same, just in terms of working with creatives, you know, and really understanding what makes them tick and what drives them creatively. And you know, so I think the psychology part of it remains the same. I think the tools to reach fans have changed dramatically. You know, so where, you know, and just information moves so quickly now, you know, we have to keep up with it, you know. And so so I think the job of a manager really happens in real time now versus, you know, us being able to dictate the pace before.
Yeah, I guess everything moves more quickly, and as opposed to sort of looking at sound scan and sales at retail, you sort of have the information at your fingertips at all times.
Yeah.
And when we get to sort of some of the artists that you manage, we'll talk about maybe the differences of some of the more recent ones, what you've seen. Mm-hmm. But let's sort of start at the beginning. Where were you born? Where were you raised?
West Philadelphia, born and raised.
Heard that before.
You know, come from West Philly, came up with Jazzy Jeff and Fresh Prince and those guys. I was a, you know, little kid in the neighborhood, wanted to be in the music business, and just so happened that I lived in the same neighborhood as DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince. And I thought I was gonna be a rapper, and we had this little group, and we said, you know, one day we're gonna meet Will Smith, and if we meet Will, he's gonna give us a record deal. And we waited outside of Jazzy Jeff's studio. We used to, it was a train called the L train that used to go in near Jazzy Jeff's studio, and we didn't have money. So we would wait until we saw the train coming on the platform, and we would run and jump over the turnstiles and, you know, sneak our way on the train. And for months we went down, and Jeff would never let us in the studio. So yeah, I think he was afraid of us. And but one day our friends were recording in there, and they let us in, and it just so happened that Will Smith was downstairs recording. And we kind of came in, and we put on our music and start performing for him, and quickly found out that we sucked at what we did. But I was lucky enough for those guys to kind of take me under their wing and pretty much adopt me. And when Will came out to do Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, I moved out to L.A. I hated L.A., moved back to the East Coast, and I was promoting concerts. And one of the shows that I was promoting was an artist, Notorious B.I.G., and I met the head of his label, P. Diddy. And Diddy gave me a job, and I started working for Bad Boy and, started building from there.
So that's right at like 17, 18, 19?
No, that kind of went through a period. I met Will and those guys when I was about 17, and I think I met Puffy when I was 21.
Okay.
Yeah.
And just to step back briefly, how brothers and sisters, what did your family do for work?
Yeah, so I have two brothers, single mom, kind of raised me and my brothers on our own, and but hardworking. She worked at Children's Hospital for 30 years, got up 5:30 in the morning every morning to go to work. And my dad had gotten in trouble. He was in prison from the time I was 7 until about 20. So really didn't have a relationship there. But I was lucky enough to have a mom who really, really taught me the value of putting the boots on the ground, getting to work, not really making excuses for yourself or anything like that, and learned my work ethic and hustle from there.
It's funny, Gary was here last week, and immigrant mentality just said, I just am going to out hustle everybody. As a kid growing up poor, and I'm not saying you, I sort of came from that background, it sucks. But when you get older, do you sort of appreciate sort of how it formed you?
Yes, but being broke, nobody likes being broke, right? But what I do appreciate is, from a very young age, I think from the time I was probably, I started working, no exaggeration, when I was probably 9 years old. So it was a neighbor on my block who, Miss Leonard, who, she was the only Caucasian woman in our neighborhood, and she had to be about 70 years old. She lived in the house by herself, and I would help her, I would run errands for her. And she had this library in the front room of her house, as a kid, a 9-year-old kid, it felt like the Library of Congress, but the reality is probably, a few books on the shelf, but, I'd never seen that before. So she gave me my love of books and taught me, things from, I was planting peanuts at 9 years old. She was teaching me, how to garden and all of these things or whatever. So I think from a culture perspective, I was learning a lot at a young age. But at 11, when it was a snowstorm, I was the first person out of the house with my shovel, shoveling neighbor's snow for $3. And, we would do it until we were frostbitten or whatever. And then in the summers, I would mow people's lawn and cut grass and things like that. So I never really had to ask. I never really depended on my mom for money and things like that or whatever. I always had that thing where I felt like I had to work to get what I wanted.
It's a great trait to have early on, and you just will run a different
game. My kids don't have that, by the way.
that's one of the biggest challenges of raising affluent kids, particularly first generation. All of our friends.
No, they're not affluent. I am. They're not.
Yeah, I'm sure you're going on vacation alone, not taking with. But that could be a topic for another whole class. So let's talk about sort of the next step in your career, discovering a 19-year-old female rapper, mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. Tell us about sort of the breakthrough that was.
Yeah, I built this reputation in Philly. The good thing is it was a great opportunity because back then, no promoters could promote hip hop shows because you couldn't get insurance. So the guys, who now have turned into Live Nation and some of the big promoters, they were all scared of rap shows. And I was really out there, you know, and we grew up during like a really bad drug era in Philly, you know, when crack hit our neighborhoods, you know, it just was terrible. And most of the older guys in the neighborhood, they wouldn't let me sell drugs. Like, even when I tried to sell drugs, they wouldn't let me. But they gave me money to promote these concerts, which later I found out is called money laundering. But now, but as a kid, you don't know, hey, I'm promoting a show, you take cash? And I was promoting these concerts, and I was building a reputation or whatever, as you know, if you wanted to go to a hot show in Philly, whether it's Wu-Tang Clan, you know, Jay-Z, Biggie, all of these guys, I was the guy that was promoting these shows, and I would meet local rap artists. So when a friend of mine who was a local rap artist, she was looking for a manager, she came to me for me to help her find a manager, and she gave me the opportunity to do it. I took her to, like, you know, a bunch of meetings, and she just said one day, you know, why don't you do it? And that was the rapper Eve, and I started working with Eve from there.
So that's 1999 when you started. Give us, you know, again, these guys are 18, so 1999, they're three.
Wow.
Yeah. So give us sort of the trajectory of Eve's career, sort of what she did, and you know, some of the things you accomplished together.
Yeah, Eve and I had fun. You know, what I loved about Eve, you know, and she was one of one, you know, so when you saw her, you know, short blonde haircut, very, very fashionable, and she was the only female out of the Rough Riders crew with DMX and all of these guys, so she really stood out. And and we spoke the same language. You know, she was from Philly, I was from Philly. You know, she reminded me of every girl that I kind of grew up in the neighborhood with or whatever. And so I got her right away. And you know, she and I did some incredible things just in terms of, you know, breaking records in terms of, you know, from touring to, you know, selling albums. And you know, we went and got a TV show, you know, did a fashion line and things that, not only rappers, but females rappers didn't traditionally do. We kind of broke a lot of those barriers down.
And at the same time, you're managing her. You had your own management group.
Yeah, I kind of built the management group around her. You know, so I didn't have a company prior to Eve, and but you know, once you know we worked together for, you know, probably for a year or two before I even took on another client. So, you know, once I decided to take on more clients, I kind of built the company around her.
And the name of the company again?
It was Irving Wonder.
Irving Wonder, and with your partner was?
Jay Irving, and he's still my partner to this day.
Son of?
Dr. J. Julius Irving.
More Philadelphia royalty.
Exactly.
You're with a good group, sounds like, all the way. In 2004, I believe, you sell the management company to Sanctuary.
Yes.
And then you join them as, yes, like an executive vice president. What happened there?
You know, Jay and I, you know, Jay was building, we were actually kind of like arch enemies in Philly. And, you know, I thought my group was cool, you know, who I hung out with. Jay thought his group, were cool, but I felt like they're suburban kids and, you know. And a friend of ours brought us together, and he said, you know what, you have this management thing that you're doing, Jay has a management thing that you're doing, you guys should just kind of combine forces. And we formed this really cool boutique talent management company called Irving Wonder. And you know, the whole idea was to only sign one of one. You know, so no artist should ever compete with each other internally or anything like that. And you know, we had this cool, you know, not even cool office. It was in a basement downtown with no windows. And it was like a casino, how like you never know what time of day it is or whatever. And but you know, we built something really cool in boutique, and we sold it to a company called Sanctuary in 2004. And it was the first time I learned about what company culture means. And you know, because Jay and I, to this day, we hang out regularly and we eat dinner together, and you know, we're always on the phone, and our staff would go out with us. And then all of a sudden, I go from this company where, you know, it's cool and boutique to now, you know, we're in a company, publicly traded, 650 employees. You know, I'm doing, you know, financial reports every week. And that connection that I felt like I had with the artist in the first place, all of a sudden kind of went out the window, and it just was not, it wasn't a great experience for me. So within a year and a half, I was trying to buy the company back.
So you sell it in 2004, 2006, you and You and Sanctuary Park Company?
Yeah.
And then in 2007, what happens?
2007, so the idea after, you know, I got the company back from Sanctuary, you know, Jay moved to Atlanta. I wanted to do something different, and I was kind of bored with just where we were. Just, I felt like the truth is I wasn't inspired anymore by hip hop. And I was a huge, huge hip hop head. And I was no longer really inspired. And, but I was thinking about next stages of the business. And after about 8 years, Eve walked in one day and said she wanted to go in her separate direction. And that was like one of my first big professional shakeups at that point.
So you sell the company, part company with them, and then a year later, your main client.
And only client at the time.
So you're 35 at the time, sort of biggest client leaves you broke?
Yeah, you know,
close to it?
Yeah, you know, at that time, you know, I reinvested a bunch of money back into the business, and then, you know, up until that point, you know, Eve and I were together 8 years on a handshake. You know, it was no contract or anything like that. And so, you know, when she left, it was, you know, some outstanding commissions that were there that I was kind of dependent on or whatever. And then it just so happened that something happened in 2008 and when the world, you know, just kind of crashed completely. And, you know, so to be caught in the middle of that crash, you know, and it was one of those things. You couldn't go to the bank to borrow money because the banks weren't lending. You couldn't go to a friend to borrow money because everybody, you know, who I knew was broke at that time or, you know, couldn't access capital themselves. And it put me, the business, and my family in a very, very terrible position at that time.
So I read that your house was being foreclosed. I mean, it got desperate.
Yeah, like to the point where, you know, my wife and my mother-in-law had to pawn their wedding rings to save my house at that point. Like, you know, cars repossessed, you know, had to close my offices. I, you know, actually, you know, Will Smith and those guys gave me an office inside their facility or whatever. And coincidentally, right as all of this was happening, in the midst of it, one of my really good friends, who I'd known forever, had called me and said, "I want to introduce you to this girl," and that girl just so happened to be Lady Gaga. So this is like literally, you know, so I'm meeting her as the world's crashing or whatever, and then, you know, so it was a very, 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 very interesting story.
So, as low as you can go, do you ever think of sort of doing something else? Or was the transition sort of quick enough where you didn't sort of give it much thought?
I did do something else at that time. I was consulting for Comedy Central at that time. So it was like a random job, by the way. I'm like, why am I consulting for a comedy network? I know nothing about this or whatever, but it was a check.
Sure.
You know, it was paying the bills. And I think it was, this is right when Dave Chappelle left the network, and I think I was probably, they thought, let's find a black guy who could talk Chappelle into coming back to work. Like, all black people don't know each other. I never met Dave Chappelle in my life. But that was really their purpose, by the way. But it did, you know, and but, you know, it was one of those things. It was a really, really tough year and a half of my life. But I never wanted to stop doing music at that time. I had a lot of doubt, to be honest with you. Like, you know, just, you know, it was one moment, like, you know, because I feel like as a human being, you only can hit but so many lows before, you know, your breaking point. And, you know, so, it, I mean, like, and I'm just being candid, and I'm, you know, but, like, so the point where I had to ask the dean of my kid's school to, can you please keep my kids in school? I can't pay tuition now, but I promise you I'll pay you, right? And, you know, you got creditors and all of these things happening. And, you know, literally up at night, I'm up every night. You know, I don't know when I slept. And I remember this one point where I was driving my car down Ventura. I had a hybrid and barely had money for gas. And I just broke down and cried my face out on Ventura Boulevard. And after I did that, I set up. And I said, okay, it's time. Let me get back to work. And it was just one of those moments where I had to pull it out of myself, you know, because I think sometimes you can get kind of caught up in your own, you know, self-pity, but I'm just a firm believer you got to work your way out of these problems, and you always got to do the right thing. It's like, you know, so everybody I owed got paid, yeah. Every single person. I refused to file for bankruptcy when I could have, and I just refused to do it. I just wanted everybody who took a bet on me, I had to make sure that everybody got back what they gave, you know. So whether that was a landlord from my office, whether that was an electric company who kept my lights on, you know, while I was running that office, whether it was the phone vendors when I don't even use the phones anymore. But it was important for me to maintain that integrity and being able to handle the situation with grace.
What a lesson. It's I heard a lot of great entrepreneurs who have had, you know, lows that sort of give them the fortitude to sort of rise again. But you do have to have that chat with yourself at some point, right?
Yeah. You know, no, we were talking earlier. It's like you can't fall off the floor. You know, you can't get lower than this. Nowhere to go but up, buddy.
The good news. No, it's, you know, a lot of times we tell these stories in stories in retrospect, but it's so important for you to share that, because a lot of people just sort of see this, oh, being an entrepreneur, it's this great trajectory up and to the right, and it's anything but that, particularly in music.
No, and you know, and I invest in a lot of entrepreneurs, and I spend time across, you know, you probably name a sector, you know, I spend time there just through our portfolio companies. And, you know, the true trajectory of an entrepreneur is this, right? Like, you know, it's no just straight hockey sticks. Everybody has their moments when they're up at night. And I think it's important for us to talk openly about it with each other and, you know, and with future entrepreneurs, because people think they're in these situations by themselves, and that, you know, they've done something to screw up at some point or whatever. But, you know, I think, you know, I'm just a firm believer of, you know, God created pain for a reason, right? You know, because you get these pain points that you never want to go back to. So I just look at them as reference points, you know? And even now, when, you know, when we go through things in the business, I've learned not to panic. You know, I learned not to change being who I am in hard situations or whatever, but to really handle things gracefully and pull the lesson out of it as well. And also to talk to other people who have been through something similar and share their stories of how do you deal with that when you've gone through it.
It's really smart for someone sort of your age at the time. A lot of times when you are sort of flailing, you feel embarrassed, you don't want to talk to people because you're sort of afraid to admit what's going on and how desperate it is, but it really helps to have people that have gone through it.
Yes.
And just think of all the bad situations in business and in life, but in business, you can actually turn them into really strong situations. Because you imagine everybody who bet on him that he eventually paid off, they're his partner for life. They will never, you know, because they've been through thick and thin with you, they know who you are. So there is the opportunity, but when you're down there, it's just dark and tough. So let's talk about sort of the arc coming out of that. In 2007, you meet a young woman through, you just mentioned. Is her Stefani? Is that her?
Stephanie.
Yeah. Stephanie. Sorry, I only know her as Gaia. So, and you meet with her. She's this combination of performance artist with this sort of European dance music and pop. She had just been dropped by Def Jam. Mm-hmm. So you meet her. What do you see in her that makes you sort of go all in and say, this is someone that I want to be a partner with?
You know, I think one, you know, when she walked in, it was like, it was funny. Vince is, my buddy Vince is a really big guy, probably Vince, big guy. So, you know, the office I was in, you know, is a glass office, and you can kind of see, like, the reception area. And I see Vince walk in, and he called me. He said, I'm flying this girl in from New York, and I want to bring her to your office tomorrow. So I see Vince walk in, and then from behind Vince, you see this girl, and she has these fishnet stockings, you know, no pants on, these big glasses or whatever. And she comes in and she introduces herself, you know, hi, my name's Lady Gaga, which, you know, now it's a pretty common name, but, you know, that wasn't a common pop star name, you know, back then or whatever. But she played the music, and right away, you know, you heard, you know, just four hits in a row. And what her vision was just like nothing I've ever heard, and her conviction as well. And, you know, when she and I just kind of, you know, I think clicked right away, and I told Vince, I said, just promise me you'll bring her back. And, you know, Vince went and he did the deal with Interscope, and then he brought her back, yeah.
So tell us about the rise of her career, how you built it. Give us some of the milestones again, because these guys are young, but sort of how you built this career and some of the high points that you guys hit together. How long did it take?
It was a grind, you know, because it was one of those things where there wasn't, you know, she had just gotten dropped from Def Jam. I had just gotten fired from Eve. Vince had just lost his label deal over at Universal or whatever. And Interscope was having the worst year in the history of the company, right? So it's like four people, four entities with nothing to lose, right? But it was... nobody was paying attention. So she was this great songwriter. You know, we would take a song to the label to you know, and here's what we think is the first single. Oh, no, it's great. Let's give it to the Pussycat Dolls. You know, here's another song. Oh, that's great. Let's give it to Britney Spears. You know, so it was all of these songs that she was writing that, you know, they believed in her as a writer, but not necessarily as an artist right away. So we just spent a year grinding it out. You know, so, you know, the song, her first single, this record called Just Dance, you know, we released it in, I want to say, February of 08. And, you know, we didn't get traction on it until close to December, you know, so out of desperation, because we couldn't get radio, we started using these social media tools. Because, you know, at that time, Facebook was just coming out of .edu, Twitter was just starting to rise, YouTube was just on the rise, and we were utilizing these tools to reach audiences because we couldn't get radio.
So this is commonplace for you, but... just, you know, 7-8 years ago, social media was looked upon by the music industry as sort of the enemy of artists. They were terrified that, you know, everyone was going to pirate music and take it, and no one would buy it. And so the labels weren't really using the tools then like they do now. And so when you say grind it out, she, a lot of touring, right?
A lot of touring. We were doing 3 or 4 shows a night sometimes.
3 or 4 shows
a night. Yeah.
And domestically, internationally?
L.A.
Just here, locally.
Yeah, locally. No kidding. Okay. So we would just do nightclubs. All of a sudden, you'd see this weird girl show up on a bar with a disco stick in her hand or whatever, do 2 songs and leave, and we go to the next nightclub. And she was in, you know, my friend's Jeep Cherokee. So, you know, we were doing that like night after night, and then we took that act to San Francisco and did it there. We did it in New York. So, you know, this wasn't Staples Center.
Yeah. And... one of the things you do, you help build a platform, littlemonsters.com, mm-hmm. and that was sort of new.
Yeah.
Tell us how that worked.
Well, that came much later, and it's like, you know, so, you know, the whole thing around it was this audience engagement. You know, how can we, like I said, out of desperation, we found, you know, using these social media tools were great, and we ended up building great relationships with a lot of companies in the Valley. So from there, companies started asking us, can we advise, can we invest, and kind of, you know, built this bridge between, you know, music and technology and, you know, and startups. And Little Monsters came about. This was once the Social Network movie came out. And Gaga had called me from a screening in New York and said, I want to build a social network for my fans. And, you know, I said, okay, like, you know, so I called a friend of mine and I said, look, we want to build a social network. You know, and this guy, Joe Lonsdale, was the co-founder of Palantir. So, you know, Palantir, you know, for you guys that don't know, is probably the most credible tech company in the Valley in terms of engineering talent. And, you know, they make, they built software that allows the CIA that talks to the FBI and talks to the DEA. And I'm asking them to build something for pop stars to talk to fans. And but Joe put it together, and we recruited some of the best engineers from the Valley and got Sequoia to back us, Google Ventures to back us, and the, you know, some great companies, VCs to come on board to support it.
So give us, when did you know this is going to break, you know, after all the grinding, when did you know? And then give us some of the highlights of her career that we could share.
The moment I knew was we were playing this, if you guys been to the Wiltern Theater before,
sure.
We were playing a show at the Wiltern, and like, you know, we're building this club business, and you know, and it started getting buzzy and everything else. But one day when we playing at Wiltern, I drove by that morning on my way to a meeting downtown, and I saw fans sleeping outside of the Wiltern waiting to get in that night. And that was the moment I knew we had something. And it probably was 40 or 50 people that were sleeping out there or whatever, but all of a sudden it went from something interesting to something really interesting, seeing, you know, fans engaged like that.
It's funny, just with Gary last week, sort of like watching consumer behavior more than anything sort of indicates when you're on to something.
It's the same for us with musicians. It's like we constantly monitor consumer behavior and constantly monitor the conversation.
Yeah, that's great. So this amazing run, record-breaking run in terms of sales, visibility. I mean, she is selling more music than it seems like the rest of the industry combined at some point. Her YouTube videos have, I mean, gazillions of views, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of views, sold out concerts, awards, all that. And in personal and professional relationships, some of them don't last forever.
Mm-hmm.
And you've had sort of overcome a couple of them. What happened when that relationship sort of came to an end?
That was one of those where I think we were able to squeeze in, you know, Gaga and I worked together for 7 years. And I'm starting to learn 7 years is the lifespan of these for me with female pop stars, by the way. No, one of my buddies from Google Ventures, he said, everybody exits after 7 years. I'm like, it's not a fucking startup. This is a personal relationship for me. This is an Uber. I love it. But, you know, so... But that was one of those where, you know, it feels like, you know, we accomplished so much just in terms of breaking, you know, Michael Jackson attendance records in some places, you know, around the world. And I think what we were able to do, is there hasn't been a quicker rise of a pop star in history, you know, and I think we were able to do it at the right time, you know. So I think, you know, sometimes just all of the stars align, right? You know, you can find the right talent, the sonically, the music, you know, the technology was available. So, you know, everything that we did, I just think the timing lined up perfectly. And I think we were able to squeeze probably the equivalent of 20 years into this 7 year period. And, but I just think the relationship probably had run its course at that point, and we just had our differences and didn't work out.
I mean, that's another tough one. I guess you've been prepared, not prepared for it, but you've experienced it before. And this is someone that you probably, over the course of those 7 years, you probably spent as much time with her as family.
Yeah, you know, you basically live with this person. You know, we're on tour buses together, you know, we laugh together, you know, you go through every ups, you know, and when somebody comes to you when they're 20 years old, you know, you're seeing this person as a kid and kind of grow over a period of time or whatever. And, you know, and most of my client relationships are personal relationships as well. And this was one that, you know, it was definitely not at a great time, and my mom passed away in March of last year, but that year we found out, you know, she had breast cancer or whatever, and then, you know, and then that happened with Gaga. So just on a personal level, the loss of two really strong women in my life at the same time was personally challenging. So that part of it was tough. The effect on the business was less dramatic because I think, you know, us being prepared and having gone through pain points before, I think we were diversified enough and well-rooted enough where it didn't have that a negative effect on the business itself. The personal part, of course, you know, when you lose a relationship like that, you know, unless you just don't have a heart and you're not in it for the right reasons, anybody who's in it for the right reasons is definitely going to feel something.
Of course, you got to mourn, you got to sort of, those things don't happen overnight.
Yeah.
So you talked about diversification, and what makes the Atom Factory, I think, so unique is the way that you've diversified, I don't say away from music, but into other areas. How did you break into tech and media startups? Did you strike a deal with somebody? I read about some great deal that you struck with somebody about the music industry in exchange for the tech industry. Tell us about that. No,
that was a buddy, one of my friends. He was this kid, Joe Weinberg. He probably one of the best A&R guys ever. And it's like he discovered, you know, he was a kid, like 19 years old at Capitol Records. Told the president of Capitol, I want to sign this rapper that I just found. His name's Kanye West, and Capitol passed on him. He takes another guy, I found this other guy I want to sign, you know, his name's 50 Cent. They passed on him or whatever. So like Joe finds everything early or whatever. So, and I love him. He's best ears, like great ears in music, super great taste. Produced stuff for Jay-Z, and he calls me up on a three-way call with one of his friends, and he says, Troy, I have one of my investors, Matt Mickelson, on the phone. We want to talk to you about investing in our record label or whatever. And Matt's like, yeah, Troy, you know, I heard you're good at music. Can you give me some advice? You know, and I knew Matt's history. Matt, had done well because he created this software that Wall Street traded on and sold it to Lehman. Pre-crash, and I said to Matt, if you get me into tech, I'll get you out of music. So he had
out of music,
because you don't want to be in this thing or whatever, because he had already taken investor money or whatever, and we really made that trade. So he's the one who really introduced me to, you know, most of the tech entrepreneurs I know, and I was able to do a deal where he made his money back for his investors off the music, and we both lived happily ever after.
So you did a full tour of Sand Hill Road. You know, you've met everybody who's sort of a VC and a who's who. Matt McCall says hello, by the way. Uh-huh. He said he's in Chicago freezing, or he'd be here.
He's great.
But tell us sort of how you did that. You purposely set out to meet everybody in venture finance.
Yeah, I was really interested in what was happening in the Valley. And at that specific time, it was this war between content and distribution. So, you know, you had all of these lawsuits going on between music labels, Viacom, you know, against YouTube and all of these companies. And I went up there just more exploratory than anything else. I just wanted to find out what these kids did and who was who and what was what. And, you know, my first trip, I got off the plane at 8 a.m. and, you know, first meeting was with, you know, David Siminoff at a coffee shop. And, you know, and they gave me the rundown of all, today we're going to give you Valley 101. So they took me to startups and houses. They took me to Facebook. They took me to Google. We went to, you know, probably 11 different places. And then that night, you know, Joe Lonsdale took, you know, from Palantir, threw a barbecue for me at his house. And it was, you know, the most socially awkward people that you could find in the Valley or whatever. And, you know, trying to dance to music and, you know, the weird conversations when the person's not looking at you and, you know. And I called my wife and I said, babe, it's like Revenge of the Nerds, but the nerds won. I said, I love it up here. Like, they think I'm cool here. I'm the suit within, amongst my artists. But I approached it with humility and curiosity, and it probably was a year before I made my first investment, you know, after that or whatever. And, you know, the companies that have allowed us to invest in the companies, you know, we do the work. You know, they call us with a problem. We help them solve it. You know, they want us to activate our network for them. You know, my job is to activate the network. And, you know, and I think because, you know, being an entrepreneur for 25 years, you know, is a lot of experience, you know, and a very mature network that I have to offer, you know, our portfolio companies.
And what's interesting is you do offer some things uniquely that they can't do themselves. And I think the way the music industry has changed, where previously, you know, when you were growing up, the music was the product. That's all you sold. Mm-hmm. And that's not the case anymore. Now the music sells everything.
Yeah.
And so you can sort of bring that value. Can you sort of talk about, you know, what things that Atom Factory brings to some of its portfolio companies, what services you provide?
You know, it varies. We deal with everything from political work, you know, dealing with taxi commissions and airport commissions and, you know, things along those lines because our political relationships, to, you know, litigation strategy, to branding, to storytelling, to, you know, so like you name it, we just kind of work across the board, you know, with the companies. A lot of stuff that people wouldn't expect that we do, you know, regularly or whatever. You know, I think when you deal with as many crazy artists as we dealt with over careers, you know what crisis is like, you know, and unfortunately, I've had to deal with many, many, many crisis communication situations, you know, and you know, so a lot of what our portfolio companies deal with, you know, we kind of help them with strategy in those areas.
And Fixer, you're sort of the next generation Clarence Avon, who people call to get stuff
fixed. We do. Clarence, a mentor of mine, and Clarence is an old school fixer.
He said
he used to dial. That's when they had those rotary phones or whatever. Yeah.
So he would say he has friends in very high places and very low places.
Exactly.
Get things fixed when everything. Okay, so give us examples of some of the companies that you're involved with and invest in.
You know, we invest across the board, so it's more of an opportunity fund. So, you know, we've invested in, you know, both Uber and Lyft, Dropbox, Spotify, Warby Parker, PopChips, Wish, Styleseat, Genius, Rap Genius now is Genius. Songza, so it's about 75 companies in the portfolio. Slack is a recent investment.
So you formed a venture fund, AF Fund, is it called AF Fund?
Yeah, and it's basically just, you know, profits I've made from Atom Factory, I just kind of roll it into investing in technology companies.
No other outside partners?
No outside partners.
Okay, interesting. How do you split your time between sort of the tech startup space and the artist management space?
It's whoever has the loudest problem when I roll out of bed. That's usually the priority. But, you know, on a regular basis, you know, it's probably split pretty evenly.
And what I think is unique is that you guys are, we're used to an artist manager used to build sort of a career for an artist sort of in a singular way. You guys build brands. You know, the artist really is a brand. And you know, some of your artists you can just see that just have this sort of more enduring life than maybe sort of a, you know, one and done type of artist. Let's talk about a couple of your artists, and then we're going to talk about one of the companies that we want to feature. So some of the artists that you represent right now?
Megan Trainor we do, and like I guess to your point, like where I don't necessarily consider them brands, but what I would say is we only try to represent artists with a very unique point of view. And I think when you have a very unique, when an artist has a very unique point of view, you almost can, they become these archetypes, right? And you know, where they're clearly identifiable. Products want to be associated with them. Fans kind of flock to them or whatever. So I don't think it's as much as the work we do as much as it is. I think the work we do is we seek out artists with point of views. And then our job is to be able to help shape that point of view for our partners, you know, and then to be able to clearly articulate that to fans.
And to align them with companies and other
exactly who share similar values and the same vision. So you know, right now, you know, we're doing, you know, Meghan Trainor's a new artist that we're working on, and we signed Meghan in July of last year or whatever. And up until Gaga had been the quickest thing that I worked on, but now, you know, just the time span of being able to break artists globally is just becoming more truncated, and so Megan's all of a sudden become this global star pretty much overnight. So it's a lot of catch-up work that we have to do to be able to explain the story. So I used to have 2 years to be able to tell that story. Now I have, you know, 90 days to tell that same story or whatever, without it feeling like, you know, because I got to quickly tell the world, okay, you know what, we know how deep of an artist she is, but you know, with all about that bass becoming so big so fast, it's important that we show the world that she's not a one-hit wonder. So how do we create those layers underneath it? How do we get that other, how do we get other music out there? How do we get other people telling the story on our behalf or whatever? So there's a lot of quick work around that. John Legend's another client who, I think when John, when we met John, John's in his 10th year of his career or whatever, and, you know, very clear on who he is and what he stands for and everything else or whatever. And our job was just to really help John reestablish his urban base, you know, because that's where he originally had come from or whatever. You know, Kanye West discovered him, you know, really close to the Roots and all of those guys or whatever. And I think people started knowing John more for his philanthropy more than his music. And our job was to really help him reestablish the music career. And, you know, so we look at these at artists. When they come to us, our job is to really have a comprehensive strategy. So it's not just, let's go in the studio and let's make good music. That's not good enough anymore. It's how do we build a real strategy around this?
And John's career arc is interesting because you said it's sort of in his 10th year. And a lot of artists, I'll do it backwards, you know, they sort of take this rise, the first album release, they usually sort of drop a little bit, maybe there's a second album. And John's sort of continually plateaued and raised it, and it's, he is probably the most visible person out there. You know, you can't go to a Super Bowl, you can't go to a national championship game, he's singing the national anthem, he's on every award show, he's in Selma.
So we're overexposing him right now.
No, you can just tell. I mean, every time I see him, I'm just like, man, those guys are working hard.
And that's
the combination of talent and great support.
Yeah, it's having strategy to it, you know. And I think, you know, I think the one of the biggest problems was that John kind of floated in this gray vortex where he wasn't black enough for black audiences, and the music wasn't mainstream enough for pop audiences, so nobody really felt ownership in John Legend. So our thing was, how can we reestablish that urban audience that he comes from? So the first phase of the plan was to really, you know, take him back to urban radio stations, reintroduce him to BET, have him go out with, you know, on tour with somebody else who can complement him with urban audiences or whatever, and then slowly throughout the campaign, cross the campaign over, you know, and when you do that, and when you can write, you know, that some hit records like he wrote, and you can couple that with strategy, magical things happen.
Absolutely. As a guy who's been touring nonstop since All of Me came out and then doubled back and did it again. And any conversation about John Legend sort of brings up one of your partners, the co-president of Atom Factory, mm-hmm. Thais DeCloreas. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about bringing her on board and sort of what you look for in bringing someone at that level, I mean, an executive level into your company?
For me, you know, I come from a background of very strong women. And I think it's important in the music business that we empower women. You know, and traditionally it's a real boys club in the music business. And I think, you know, even for some of the women who had gone on to have a huge amount of success in our business, it was, you almost had to play the guy's game. You know, you almost short of having a cigar and whiskey, you know, to really be able to kind of play in that club. So as I'm, you know, look at Atom Factory, diversity is a big, big thing for me. And to be able to have a workforce that's representative of what the world is, and to be able, for me personally, I want to be able to send strong messages about stereotypes. And so when Ty came in, you know, I met John, and the funny thing with John, one of our portfolio companies, an engineer called me up one day and he said, hey, you know, my friend John's looking for management. And I'm like, okay. Then he's like, it's John Legend. I'm like, shit, okay. You got any friends named Beyonce? So it kind of came through like this random connection. And then John and I really connected. And he said, look, I have a friend of mine who I've been working with since the very beginning. You know, she's leaving the previous manager with me, and I'd like for you to meet with her to see if you guys click. And right away, you know, I fell in love with her. I think she just was super smart, very thoughtful. She really knew John well, which was really important. And she's come in, and she's been an incredible force within the company. And not just within our company, I just think within the industry overall.
She's brilliant. She's so strong. And the great relationship that they have, you can tell they trust each other intrinsically. They work so well together, and just what an asset to your company.
For sure.
She is tremendous. Speaking of talent, let's turn to younger talent that was coming from USC. We'll invite James up in a second. And I want James to share his story of where he was just a year ago. And then how you guys got together. So why don't you come on up, and then we're gonna roll a video. Can I introduce this, or do you want to introduce it?
Right.
Okay. So let's take a look at what $1,500 can create with enough vision. So play this video.
Ready for takeoff.
Tesla doesn't make commercials. How did this commercial get made, and what was the impetus behind it?
I think the real idea was to have something to leave school with, and to have something tangible to show the world, and to show someone like Troy, and to be able to come out of college with.
Can I get that every time somebody says my name?
An angel just got her wings.
we just really wanted, we didn't want it, so the commercial was done not just by me, it was me and three co-founders, which were just filmmakers and directors, and we wanted to be entrepreneurs, and we didn't want to take on normal jobs. Like, I didn't want to be an investment banker, and really it was around, again, the directors. We were graduating, and they were looking around at people in finance and technology getting great jobs, but as directors, we're like, what are we going to do? There's really no platform or infrastructure for you to get a job as a filmmaker. So for us, it was like, we want to do this, show the world that we can create something really compelling at a high level, and then hopefully to get money out of it, or to get a gig out of it, to create a company. So this was really the genesis of our company. We met Elon and...
To get noticed.
To get noticed, yeah.
Let's see who noticed.
It's a small entrepreneur.
Yes. An up-and-coming entrepreneur. He has a rocket company. How does he contact you and what happens from there?
Yeah, so it was actually quite a little bit of a hustle. We had made the commercial and I was cold emailing everybody within Tesla, SpaceX, anyone that I thought that knew him, and really just tried to get his attention. And eventually we did. And his VP of marketing said, you know, we won't pay you for it, but we're interested in seeing it. So I was like, all right, we'll just make it anyway. And then we made it and he saw it and invited us to meet with him a few times. And that was kind of really it.
So how do you meet this gentleman here? This is a really good story.
Yeah, so when I made a decision not to pursue investment banking, I actually coincidentally got a call from my advisor at Marshall. And you know, no discredit to her, but she was like, James, you actually have to take another class to graduate. I had already walked. And she's like, you need another class to get your diploma. And I was like, what the fuck do I do? Like, do I even need a diploma really at this point? And during that, literally this happened in one day. That same day, I had cold emailed another entrepreneur, a guy named Diego Burdekin, who runs a company called Beachmint. And it was just a side cold email. And I was like, hey, Diego, love to meet you and just grab coffee with you, pick your brain, give me 30 minutes notice, I'll meet you anywhere in LA. And he was like, sure, I'd be happy to do it. Or you can just take a class that I'm teaching at SC. So needed one class to graduate. And then I emailed him and he said he was teaching class. So it was just like, again, the stars had somehow aligned. And took his class, had this in kind of my back pocket. We're working with some directors. And Troy came into a class like this, was giving a talk. And Diego was like, hey, you got to show them the Tesla commercial and what you guys are doing. And went in, I think a week and a half later, while still in the class, told Troy that I wanted to do a joint venture. Within 5 minutes, he said yes. And was driving back and forth.
By the way, my wife, we just had our baby, probably. She was in the hospital as I'm meeting with these guys or whatever. So I'm like, this better be good, right?
It was.
Yeah, and so we were out of Adam Factory for, I'd say about a year and 2 months. Just moved out and are building our office and are into a new office next week.
That's a great story. That's a USC story. I got it. So why is it such a special time, not just in your business as well, but content creation? I mean, you built that for $1,500 and the bulk of it was travel to go to Northern California, right?
Yeah.
So why is this a unique time to be an emerging filmmaker?
I think, like with anything, I think technology is completely disrupted. Just the tools and, you know, from creation to distribution, I think there's nothing that you need as just an individual to be able to create something compelling and then also to get it seen by the world, right? There's just a proliferation of content out there, but I think if it's great, content is king more than ever, people are gonna see it. And I think as a filmmaker, you know, brands, media companies, TV, film houses, networks, they're all trying to get in the game of how do I create something compelling. So I think if you're a filmmaker or even a producer, you can get something together, you can really get noticed. And I think what's really interesting is the conversion of, you know, brands and film. And I think brands more and more wanting to tell great stories and not just have a 30-second spot on TV allows filmmakers to kind of, you know, work on their craft and really harness some of their tools to tell stories for brands. So that's kind of the space that we're living in, is in this longer form branded content and really using filmmakers to disrupt the traditional ad agency model.
And, you know, most startups are, you know, pre-revenue, it's a long time to profit. You've been in business for maybe a year. And how are things going? You are real revenue, profit?
Yeah, we're in size, and I actually don't even like to use size as a barometer. I'd rather be as small as possible and make more money. But we're almost 30 with a few interns full time.
That's why I had to kick them out of my office. They went from four guys, and they turned my office into a frat house with like dirty dishes. And who left the dish? I was like the old one. Who left the dishes in the sink again?
True story.
But they
True
went
story.
From 4 people to 30 people, so grew relatively quickly. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll do. The goal is to do a healthy double-figure million-dollar revenue this year.
Congratulations, that's impressive. Yeah. And speaking of space, by the way, Adam Factory is slowly taking over Washington Boulevard across from Sony Studios. Just block by block, you just see these buildings and they're his. So are you staying close by or are you guys going?
Yeah, we're just a mile east, okay. So really close by.
I think Culver City is a really unique spot right now, and as we're sort of leading our charge of where we want to put our incubator, if it's not going to be directly on campus, I think there might be a place that we should go down there, you know, get on the train now that comes right here.
Yeah.
That could be a really good
spot. No, it's really good energy. I was at the Beats by Dre office over there last week or whatever, and you know, just everything that's happening there, you know, feels really good right now in Culver City.
So I'm going to ask one more question, then we're going to play a video, and then we're going to open up to questions for both of them. I'll leave both because I know there's going to be students that particularly want to know what you did, you know, what you told your parents when you said, I'm not going the financial route, I'm going to be a filmmaker. But what impressed me about James is just he's sort of got this emotional EQ, I think, for someone his age. That's impressed me. So what drives you now at this point in your life? What motivates you? You know, is it the creative part? Is it, you know, obviously the financial part? But what really gets you out of bed and makes you want to do this?
I think I have a pretty vivid vision of where I want to be in 5 to 10 years and where I want the company to be and the impact that it can have. And to me, it's so certain that when I get up in the morning, it's like I'm excited to do it because it's like, oh, just another day at trying to accomplish this big goal. And hopefully it sets an example. And really, again, we're solving a big problem, I think, for filmmakers. And that's the real motivating, you know, charge for me is like being able to provide, you know, one day, I think, and I think it can happen in, you know, 1 to 3 years. You know, filmmakers that graduate from, you know, the thousands of film schools across the country to be able to say, like, I want to go work at Everdream. And right now, that nothing really exists. If you really think about it, as a filmmaker, if you graduate college, where are you going? You're going to be a starving artist, you're freelance, you can go to CAA and make $30,000 in an agency, which really is, again, don't do that either, or go grab coffee for a studio exec. And I think, you know, it's the best time to be a creative, and I think I just really want to empower that.
Yeah, it's a great, and great that you have roots here because you can really pick off a lot of talented graduates.
So I might be teaching a class actually here at the film school in a couple months, and we might even be doing a partnership with the school, so it's exciting.
Well, whatever we can do to help, we want to do that because I just think this is a great synergy. And we got a friend of ours, Anthony Borquez, who teaches both engineering and business. He's hired 50 engineers. 50 USC engineers right out of his class. I think he teaches just to recruit talent. So there's the selfless and the selfish motivations. But before we open to questions, I want to play a video that that Everdream created for John Legend. And it's one of those that when you see it, you never forget it. And it's just the power of great talent, the power of storytelling, and this vision. So can you play You and I by John Legend? 1 year out, not bad, guys. Questions for James and Troy, let's go.
Name is Daniel, question first off for James. So $1,500 you said was the budget for the Tesla video. Can you give me a breakdown of where that went?
Yeah, it actually, to be honest, wasn't even $1,500. It just sounded a little bit more round. It was more like $700, and it was really just a hotel room that me and nine people. We slept in a room at a Holiday Inn, spent money on gas, and we fed the crew. And that was pretty much it.
How'd you get like all the actors and stuff?
The Tesla we got through a friend of mine's dad. The house was my friend's dad. The actor, the director had worked in it at film school. It was really just a hustle, scrappy, put something together.
Then question for Troy. So you said what used to keep you up at night back when, you know, the recession, everything went kind of bad for you and Eve left you was you stayed up at night because you didn't know what was going to happen and was a little bit out of uncertainty. I'm not going to say out of fear because it was out of uncertainty of, you know, what am I going to do? I'm going to do it, but I don't know how I'm going to do it. So what keeps you up at night now?
My kids, probably. it depends, you know. It could be an employee issue. It could be an artist issue. You know, and generally, I could say, you know, I sleep pretty well, but something any given day might raise its hand that, you know, that you worry about. But I think one of the things when you know your CEO or boss and everybody depends on you and you got to be the guy that comes up with that answer. So sometimes that just keeps you up at night, just knowing that you got to come into the office that next morning with a solution to whatever problem.
And payroll for everybody.
No, exactly.
It's not that significant.
Thanks for coming to speaking to us, Mr. Carter. I was wondering if you could just expand a little bit more about the years that you spent living in LA before going back to Philly and your experiences then and how that shaped the rest of your career.
I think those years were, you know, it's, I think I always have that hustle, but you know, back then it was all about the hustle. So it was promoting shows, it was figuring out, you know, the reason why I hated LA, because it was, in Philly, you can become famous in your neighborhood really quick if you throw good parties, right? Everybody's somebody, or think there's somebody in LA. And it just is a really tough place to navigate, just kind of coming in, you know, especially from the city. And now I think, you know, probably because, you know, my family's here and our root, you know, we have deep roots here. We've been here 11 years now. It's much easier. But I meet a lot of people who still come in from other places that still have that tough time kind of navigating the town. But I was a hustler, to sum it up.
Cool. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Hi, my question is for Troy. Hi, Troy. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Jesse Haney. I study actually business and entrepreneurship, but I work in music. Actually, I pitched the ceremonies back in the day when I did A&R at Columbia. Yeah, it didn't work out, obviously. and then actually when I became a rep, a Sony rep, Megan's one of our big priorities. Will you actually be at the show next week? Side note.
Yes, I'll be there.
Cool. Okay, cool. See you there. My question, I have two questions. The first is, what do you see the future of majors being like in the future? And do you see the roles changing? And my second question is, will you be here after? Because I have a question about tour managing.
About what?
Tour managing?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think there's always going to be a role in the near future and probably the foreseeable future for music labels. You know, I think they, you know, I don't think it's the only place for artists to go. And I think there's always been a healthy ecosystem of independent acts and major label acts. And now, you know, we're seeing, you know, a huge rise of independence. But we're also seeing a huge rise of the major labels. They control a lot of catalog, real estate. They empower, you know, they power all of these streaming services with rights. And to really build a global superstar in this day and age, I still think you need the infrastructure and support from and financial support from a label partner. So I think they're getting smarter as they evolve for sure. And I think, you know, like Universal Music Group, I think they have great leadership in place with Lucian Grange. I think he's very, very forward thinking. And so I do think it's going to be a place for major labels.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sure. And the second one, will you be here after for tour managaging question?
Probably not, but if you could catch me on the way out, I'd probably get answered.
We promised that we'd get him out, but we'll make sure you can get your question answered.
Perfect.
Who's up?
Hi, Troy, James. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm so curious as to how the whole conversation and relationship started between you guys. Like, what were you thinking when this young grad from USC was like, hey, you want to do a joint venture with me? Like, what was going through your mind? And what was going through your mind when you're approaching somebody like Troy?
I'll let him answer first.
Yeah.
No, so when literally I was on my way out of the class, and then, you know, James and I caught up in the hallway, and he showed me the Tesla spot. And in my mind, for some reason, I'm thinking, okay, maybe he worked on it as a production assistant, you know, sort of thing. No way a college student did this or whatever. And then I'm thinking, you know, maybe they spent, you know, a few million bucks producing it for Tesla. It didn't register what, you know, exactly what it was. And once he explained it, you know, he came in and talked about the business model. And, you know, and working very closely in the Valley, you know, the concept, you know, if you're in the top 1% of engineers in Silicon Valley at Stanford, you know, you're being recruited by Facebook, LinkedIn, Google, you know, it's such a career track for you. But, you know, like James said, if you're coming out of, you know, top 1% from USC, Chapman, or NYU, you're being a production assistant or getting coffee for somebody. So to be able to build this sort of career track for young creatives, but also disrupt traditional advertising and production companies, I know what our spend is a year on it, and I know what our label partners spend is a year, and to be able to do it for that sort of that value and that value proposition was really attractive. And also, right away, you know, James and his partner, RJ, I just believed in them. It's just something when this conviction that, you know, for me, I've been lucky enough to be able to recognize it in artists and entrepreneurs. Like, you know, when they're in my vicinity, you can kind of feel that thing. And they walked into the room with that thing, and my job was to block and tackle for these guys, and just to make sure as many people as I know knew about them, and that my organization could support them, and get out of their way. You know, that's the best thing. The best thing I learned that if you can get out of the way of talented people, they do really, really well. And I just got out of their way, and I'm there when they need me, and sort of serve as, you know, a confidant, big brother, mentor, and student a lot of times, because I think I learned a lot from James and RJ. Yep.
To answer your question, I think I personally, and RJ, my partner, we went in very prepared. Hopefully he recognized it, but we were up 12, 16 hours a day for, you know, the 2-week span that we had the meeting booked, and really thought about, because we knew the business model going into it, but we wanted to figure out how it aligned with what Troy and Atom Factory are doing, and really, you know, confided in other mentors and positioned in a way where it was a no-brainer for him. So,
now, and the funny thing is, I'm thinking, it's crazy, is that I met these two other kids in the class that day who was calling me for a meeting, and they came in and pitched me a similar idea just in terms of this production company, da da da. And so for almost 2 weeks, I thought that they were the guys who did the Tesla spot.
So funny.
So until I asked them about, you know, I said, can you show such and such the Tesla spot? And they're like, we didn't do that. So I had to figure out a way to get out of that deal.
They're still mad at me, by the way.
I think they might still be mad at me. But I was, but that's actually what happened. But it was, and I thought those guys were great guys, but it was just something that I think James and his team possessed. And even just in terms of seeing their leadership, you know, these are really, you know, these are young guys, you know, so I didn't have that executive maturity when I started my company. It was, you know, we were really, really raw, and the amount of sophistication, integrity, and grace that these guys kind of operate with, and that they lead the rest of the team with. And when you can lead a team with those principles, anybody will follow you. And that's what I really, really noticed and respected about these guys.
Love that. All right, we'll get over here. Give this side of the room some love.
Thank you guys for... You've worked with musicians and the entrepreneurial tech community, and they're obviously both creative communities that, you know, create incredible products. I wanted to know what the similarities and differences that you've seen in those two on the creative side. What are the kind of ones that stand out or that have stood out to you?
I think there's a lot of similarities between great entrepreneurs and great artists. You know, so where nothing's more important than the product. I think that you know, so where great artists and songwriters is all about the song and the art and the performance and the things that really count. And when you're dealing with a great entrepreneur, they are 100% laser focused on the product and the outcome of that product. So there's a lot of similarities there. And also just the some intangible elements as well, just, you know, from personality types, lots of similarities there. I think there's a lot of difference between technology companies, when, you know, as we look at them as companies, you know, just because that's dealing with, you know, larger companies, be it like Google or, you know, specifically Google, you know, we run into issues when we talk about how do you communicate with people, you know, because there's a lot of sensitivity and care when we deal with fans. And, you know, something goes wrong at a technology company, chances are, you know, a lot of them don't have good customer service skills, right? You know, things have happened with, you know, whether it's Airbnb and, you know, and some of the you know, debacles that they've dealt with, you know, or Uber, you know, for instance, and some of the things that they've dealt with. So the way we deal with our communities is with a lot more sensitivity than I think a lot of that comes when you're building a technology company. And those are just general statements that I can give specific examples around, but that's one of the biggest differences that I see.
Hi, my name is Kevin Korb. I play competitive table tennis, run the largest Instagram table tennis related account, and I'm working to brand myself within that sphere. You talked about how with your different artists, each of them you pursued different kind of quirks with each one so they didn't overlap. And my question for you is really, how do you go about pinning down your approach and building that brand that you want to develop for an individual?
It's not a simple answer because it's not one size fits all. So every single strategy is kind of tailored to a specific client at a specific time in their career, at a specific time in the world. You know, so it kind of depends on what tools are available, you know, what the competitive landscape looks like. You know, so there's a lot of things that have to go into it. If you could clarify, and like, do you want to personalize the question a bit more?
Sure. I'm looking to do something with table tennis as a career, mm-hmm. Either on the business side or social media side of it. Mm-hmm. And I'm currently talking with different companies that are interested in using me as a spokesperson or using me to develop my own brand. And really, I'm looking for some advice on how to sort of take what I have now, being a kid who goes to USC and plays ping pong, to something where people around the world or globe, hopefully, will say, "Oh, that's the ping pong guy."
Got to be one of one.
No, that's not exactly. You hit it on the nose. Nah, so one of the things, James just hit it on the nose, and like, you know, it's the whole one of one thing, right? And I believe in very laser focused niche, right? You know, so, and because I think you can take laser focused niche and make it really, really broad at the end of the day. But if you can own a category, and when people think about the category, they think of you. And I think in a digital space, specifically with Instagram and Snapchat, and you know, and other, you know, and even now with Facebook Video, it's a real way to be able to tell incredible, to do incredible storytelling and to do incredible branding, and you know, not knowing a lot about, you know, the table tennis space. You know, my guess is that you would be able to really innovate in a space that's probably been stale for a long time. And you have a lot of brands that have been around for a long time that are probably looking for some sort of innovation or spokesperson. You know, we're seeing a lot that's happening like in beauty categories, for instance, and, you know, in all of these other categories. But I think it's a real opportunity there.
And he's got a ton of followers.
How many, if you give me lessons, then we can probably do a trade off.
I'll go to wherever you want to play.
Perfect. We're going to exchange some info.
When you get the answer you want, you take it. That is the best offer you'll get for ping pong.
We're going to exchange.
We are running a little bit at behind, so I want to close with a couple things. Brianna, you want to come up? We got a little presentation from the students. Come on up. There you go.
Half our class, and thank you for coming tonight. It was truly inspirational.
I want to bring these balls up. Oh, bring those up.
Yeah. We can share it, but I'll just keep it at mom.
We've got some graph. This one, we hope this will go on both of their cars, but this one for James more than anything. You know, when you get the USC Marshall Entrepreneur License Plate frame, wear that proudly.
I got the alumni one
and
already.
Then, you know, when you feel, you know, the company softball team, you can always go out with our logo. But we promised we'd get them out by 10 to 8, but I want to do something before they leave because, like I said, when I met Troy, the first time I met Troy, I asked him to come on the spot. He's like, I love to do it. I really love to teach and give back. And you see that James and Troy share a lot of sort of the same values when it comes to that. So what we want to do.
Selfie.
No selfie. I don't do
that. That's a long lead up to a selfie, right?
I've got the longest arms. They don't even look like selfies. You know, you also heard about guys who take so many selfies. That's not a good thing. So here's what we want to do. Saw a lot of notes, and I know a lot of lessons from Troy and from James. So shift forward five years from now. What lessons, advice, and just sort of quotes of wisdom are you going to take with you? I want to see hands. Ready? Go.
Trajectory is not a straight hockey stick.
Combine talent with strategy.
Maintain integrity. Handle it with grace.
Pain is a reference point.
Do not panic.
Surround yourself with quality people.
Out-hustle everybody.
God created pain for a reason. We hit these low points and realize we never want to be there again.
Only listen out of hard situations.
Speak up loudly.
You can't fall off the floor. If you get out of the way of really talented people, they do very well. There's nowhere to go but up.
Approach it with humility and curiosity.
Work your way out of your problems.
One of one. Own your attitude.
Last one. Who's got one?
It's important to put boots on the ground and not make excuses for yourself.
Please help me thank James Cabanchani and Troy Carter.
First of many.